Problem, technical problem with my video. Is it okay? Ramkrishna?
Sir, good morning, sir.
Good morning. There is some problem with my video.
Okay, sir. Sir, what happened, sir, actually?
I do not know. Same camera.
Okay.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Very good morning to everyone. I welcome everyone for this webinar conducted by Department of Physics on conducting polymer nanocomposites and its applications. So now I will welcome Dr. Mini, Professor and Ed, Department of Physics, AMCEC.
Good morning to one and all present today. It's my pleasure to welcome everyone to this webinar today. We appreciate your presence at this difficult time. Myself, Dr. Mini, HOD Physics, AMCEC. We would like to extend a special welcome to Dr. MVN Ambika Prasad, sir, today's speaker. We would especially like to say welcome to our management, principals, our principal, Dr. A.G. Natraj, sir, deans, HODs, faculty from other colleges and our college, students, research scholars, and professionals from industry. Today's webinar topic is conducting polymer nanocomposites and its applications. Compared to other conductive materials like transition metal nanoparticles, carbon nanotubes, or carbon black, nanostructured conducting polymers have better moldability, processability, and tunability, meaning that they are more easily processed into various forms such as thin films, coatings, powders, and hydrogels. Conducting polymer nanocomposites are used in many fields like sensors, battery, supercapacitors, fuel cells, solar cells, microwave applications, etc. They can be synthesized easily, lightweight in nature, and cost effective. Ambika Prasad sir is working on this field for many years, and many of his students, including my guide, Dr. Devendrappa, they all established very sophisticated labs regarding this. And even in AMCEC, we have got approval from VTU in 2017, and we are in the starting of establishing a lab. Myself and Dr. Chakradhar, my colleague, we both worked in this field, and my application was in supercapacitor, and Chakradhar worked in sensors, and students joined under us, and we are in the starting of the same field. Anyway, I'm not extending this introduction. We are so excited to have you all to participate in this webinar today, organized by Department of Physics, AMCEC. I hope that you all enjoy today's session. Over to Ramakrishna.
Thank you, ma'am. Now I welcome our beloved principal, Dr. Natraj sir, to just guide us.
Good morning, ellarigu namaskara. Good morning to one and all. Good morning, sir, Dr. Ambika Prasad.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir. Good morning, all participants of this webinar. I'm very happy that Dr. Ambika Prasad has accepted our invitation, and this will go a very long way with respect to our institution and our research scholars from AMCEC. I'm also wish to congratulate Dr. Mini, Professor and Head of the Department of Physics of our institution, and our team for organizing this webinar. On this COVID-19 period, it has been organized. I just take 2 minutes and speak about my institution. AMC Engineering College was established in the year 1999. We have completed 21 years of our progress, and we are stepping into 22nd year. It has been started by Dr. K.R. Paramahamsa, our chairman under Paramahamsa Foundation Trust, along with Dr. Srimati Geeta Paramahamsa, Srimati Monica Kalluri, Vice President, and Sri Rahul Kalluri, our Executive Vice President. The specialty of our trust is all trustees are highly educated in India and in abroad also. Our institution runs our seven undergraduate courses, namely civil engineering, mechanical engineering, electrical and electronics engineering, electronics and communication engineering, computer science and engineering, information sciences and engineering, and mechatronics engineering. From this current year, that is 2020-2021, we are starting a new course, one in artificial intelligence and machine learning with an intake of 60, and aeronautical engineering with an intake of 60. These two fields have been proposed to start because these are the very well wanted courses by the students in future. Also, government of Karnataka has establishing a 5,000 acre land to start aeronautical or aerospace engineering near International Airport in Bengaluru. We have a fantastic collaborators. We have around 10 lakh square feet of buildings. We have fantastic laboratories. We have good library, which contains around 75,000 volumes. And we have e-libraries. We have been affiliated to VDU. We have been sanctioned from AICT, New Delhi. We have 6 PG courses. Also, we have MBA and MCA. All the departments are doing research. Around 60 members are registered for their PhD in different departments. The specialty of our institution is we have published nearly 300 papers in this academic year, and that is really a great job doing by our staff members. We have very dedicated staff members in our institution. We have 7 patents to our kitty. We have more than 52 ranks from VTU to our institution. So with all this, I wish to say that we have organized this webinar, and we again thank Dr. MVN Ambika Prasad for accepting this, and also the Department of Physics in organizing this. Namaskar. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to speak for 2 minutes. Over to Dr. Ramakrishna. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. It was a wonderful introduction, and we carry your blessings for today's webinar. And before handing over to Chakravarti sir, I would give a small instructions to the participants, sir. Now, there are 2 things which we need to observe. All participants, you cannot mute or unmute. Any queries can be answered only in the chat box or in questions that will be answered at the end of a session. And regarding the feedback and the certification, at the end of a session, we will display a QR code. And I request all the participants to scan the QR code and save the same link. I repeat again. After the end of the session, we'll display the QR code. I request all the participants to scan the QR code and save the link. And the link will be activated after 24 hours. And those who are logged in using the Zoom link, automatically the link will be sent after 24 hours, and the link will be active for next 24 hours. Within that time, you need to fill the link. Automatically, the certificate will be generated and it will be popping up in your inbox, sir. So I request all the participants, sir, any questions, you can put it in chat box. That will be discussed at the end of a session. And now I'll invite Dr. Professor Chakravarti sir.
Very good morning to one and all. Myself, Dr. Chakravarti, Department of Physics, AMC Engineering College. Today, it is my pleasure to introduce the guest of speaker, Dr. MVN Ambika Prasad sir. Dr. MVN Ambika Prasad sir did his graduation from Usmaniya University, Hyderabad, obtained doctorate from IIT Delhi, and postgraduate from California University, USA. He worked as a professor in the Department of Physics, Gulbarga University, Gulbarga, and also as a chairman in the Department of Material Science, Gulbarga University, Gulbarga. Presently, he is working as a
అవి చెద్దర్లు
డాక్టర్ చక్రధర్ సార్ ఐ థింక్ యువర్ వాయిస్ ఇస్ మ్యూటెడ్
సారీ వెరీ గుడ్ మార్నింగ్ టు వన్ అండ్ ఆల్ మైసెల్ఫ్ డాక్టర్ చక్రధర్ డిపార్ట్మెంట్ ఆఫ్ ఫిజిక్స్ ఏఎంసీ ఇంజనీరింగ్ కాలేజ్ బెంగళూరు టుడే ఇట్ ఈస్ మై ప్లెజర్ టు ఇంట్రడ్యూస్ ద గెస్ట్ ఆఫ్ స్పీకర్ డాక్టర్ ఎంవిఎన్ అంబికా ప్రసాద్ సార్ డాక్టర్ ఎంవిఎన్ అంబికా ప్రసాద్ did his PhD, did his graduation from Usmania University, Hyderabad, obtained doctorate from IIT Delhi, and postgraduate from California University, USA. He worked as a professor in the Department of Physics, Gulbarga University, Gulbarga, and also as a chairman in the Department of Material Science, Gulbarga University, Gulbarga. Presently, he is working as a BSR faculty fellow in the Department of Physics. He is the only one person who got UGC BSR fellowship from Karnataka in physics. His research areas are synthesis of conducting polymer, nanomaterials, and its sensor applications. He guided 22 PhD students and 14 MPhil students and more than 200 PG students for their research projects. He has also completed many DST, VGST, and UGC funding projects. And also he worked for a RUSA as a coordinator from Gulbarga University, Gulbarga. Sir has published more than 130 papers in reputed journals, national and international journals. Today, on behalf of AMC Engineering College, Department of Physics, I heartily welcome to Dr. MVN Ambika Prasad sir for this webinar session. Over to Dr. MVN Ambika Prasad sir. Thank you.
Very good morning to all of you. At the outset, I thank the principal, Professor Nagaraj, Dr. Chakradhar, HOD, Dr. Binu, Mini Madam, and Dr. Ramkrishna, and all the management of the AMC College of Engineering for giving me an opportunity and share my ideas about my work. Today, my topic of my research is on conducting polymer nanocomposites and its applications. I'll share the screen now. 1 minute. Yeah, I hope you are able to listen to me.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So the title of my talk is on conducting polymer nanocomposites and its applications. And a brief outline of my talk is introduction to different materials. And when we talk about materials, we talk about polymers, we talk about ceramics. And then I also talk about a new area of polymers that has come into existence about 50 years ago, the conducting polymers. Then I also discuss what are the various types of conducting polymers and their applications. We also discuss the conducting polymer composites, specifically in sensor applications. This is the area where I have worked quite a bit. And then also polymer electrolytes application to batteries. Conducting polymers have wide applications in microwave properties, which is of immense help in the defense sector. And there are also some of the mechanical properties which are carried out. And I conclude my talk. These are the brief outline of my talk. So the areas of work, what we have carried out in our department, I mean, the Department of Material Science and Physics, is one thing is we work on nanomaterials, we work on ceramics, we work in polymers, and some of the composites and biomedical materials. You can see many of the nanomaterials whose particle size is about 6 to 14 nanometers. You can see a TEM image of a nanomaterials where you can see that, you know, it has about 14 nanometer size. We can see the cell attachment to surface, spider silk, and micro dielectric ceramics. Spider silk is one of the, you know, one we study is because it's one of the hardest material we come across. Before I go into my talk, let me also discuss what are the various materials we come across in our daily life. We talk about materials as what are known as smart materials. So in smart materials, essentially, we have three types of materials we come across. One are metals and alloys, one is polymers, one is ceramics and glasses. And if you make a composite between metals and alloys and polymers, you get what are known as steel cord tires. Similarly, when you make a composite between metals and alloys, ceramics and glasses, you get what is known as MMC, that is metal matrix composites. Then if you make a composite between polymers and ceramics and glasses, you got carbon fiber reinforced plastics and glass fiber reinforced plastics. So these are what are known as materials. And then you talk about what are known as the various composites. So this is the brief idea of what are smart materials. Now, basic characteristic of different type of materials. You talk about metals. Metals is one of the very, you know, all of us, we come across metals. You know, copper, you know, silver, gold, all of these materials are what are known as metals. So these are metals which are nothing but element with free delocalized outer electrons. And then we come across what are known as polymers. We can see polymers in our daily life. So we even you take your toothbrush or the TV, you know, TV screen. So many of the things we come across in our daily life, they are nothing but polymers. Polymers are nothing but long chain organic. It has a combination CCR and composites. It does not mean all the polymers are organic. Some of the polymers are inorganic also, but most of the polymers we come across are organic polymers. Then we come to other type of materials, what are known as ceramics. These materials are nothing but it is a compounds between metals and non-metals. And then we talk another type of you know, materials, what are known as composites. Composites are nothing but it is a combination either of metals or polymers. Polymer ceramic, it is basically a combination of two or more materials. What are the uses of these materials? All these materials have immense applications in information storage, color imaging, bioprocessing, magnetic refrigeration, ferrofluids, quantum dots, etc. So what are the various types of interactions you come at on materials is, you have a material, you can design the material, you can process the material. That's how you, then you can look into various applications of each of the material. And we'll first come across one of the important materials which we come across in our daily life, what are known as polymers. So what in my talk I would like to tell you, first I will talk about some of the bulk, you know, materials in the bulk form, then I will go to the, you know, nano size when we go to the nanomaterials. First, let me talk about, you know, materials which we study in the bulk, then go back to so that you will clear how the, you know, what is the transition that are taking place, what are the changes that are taking place. So one of the important excited areas in chemistry, chemical engineering and physics and material science deals with the preparation, synthesis, characterization, evaluation and application of polymers. And polymers are also macromolecules, constitute a group of materials made up of long chain built of covalently bonded molecules. What are the properties of polymers? Polymers are generally very weak. They are ductile. They are low density materials. They are insulators. They can be conductors. Why I have put that conductors is later we came into existence of new type of polymers which are known as conducting polymers. But earlier days, we all know that polymers are nothing but they are insulating materials. You know, in the common example like PVC pipes, which we have in our house, PVC pipes are very common. Everybody knows they are nothing but they have the property of insulation. That is why that is used there. But of late, about 50 years back, you come into new type of polymers have come into existence. They are what are known as conducting polymers. So that we will discuss in the later part of my talk. So polymer, it is not an exaggeration to say that polymers, we are in polymer age, and 21st century belongs to synthetic polymers. The use of synthetic polymers increasing year by year, and many applications, they are replacing the conventional metals like metal, ceramics, or natural fibers such as cotton, etc. Now, why I've used this word is many materials have been replaced. So here, when you talk about conducting polymers, we know that many of the materials we use, like metals, aluminium, copper, you know, silver, gold, they are known as conductors. But they have been replaced by polymers, what are known as conducting polymers. So they are replaced by this type of materials. In fact, science of polymers has its roles in physics, chemistry, because basically this polymers is a highly interdisciplinary area. The chemists are a person who synthesize and prepare the materials. Physics people, they study its properties and applications. And biology people, biopolymers, biology people use. And engineering people, particularly mechanical engineering and all, they have immense role in the polymer science, because whatever we study in the applied science has to be translated into industry. You know, that material has to be used in industry, where engineers and technologists have come into play. So these polymeric material or polymer science has a highly interdisciplinary area. And in fact, there are many other materials, ceramic materials like ferrites, zinc oxide, titanium oxide, other materials also are can be employed, and they can be used for sensing materials, because sensing is one of the very important application. You have humidity sensing, you have gas sensing, you know, lot of applications are there, and where all these polymeric materials have been used. And they're exactly use materials like polyaniline, polyethiopian redox, which are nothing but conducting polymers. Anyway, I'll discuss that part later. But why polymers have been extensively used is, the first thing is they are lightweight, and they can be processability is very easy. And there have been increasing interest to employ conducting polymers, and their conducting polymer, metal, ceramic, nano composites for areas like light emitting diode, polymer light emitting diodes. In addition, it is application gas sensing like NH3, H2O, CH4, hydrogen, liquefied petroleum gas, ethanol, etc. In all these cases, conducting polymers can be employed to study their, you know, sensing properties. In addition to that, there are a lot of other you know, applications where it can be studied, and holistic view of understanding of this one can help in various other applications. But how polymers can be classified is, polymers are classified based on their, whether they are natural or synthetic, type of polymerization use, type of chain structure, and solid state behavior, etc. So you classify polymers as natural and synthetic polymers, addition and condensation, homochain and heterochain, monodispersed, polydispersed, organic, inorganic, homopolar, linear, branched and cross-linked, charged and uncharged, thermoplasts and thermosites, fibers, plastics, elastomers, symbiotic and attack polymers. And these are some of the structures of the polymers we come across, like polyethylene, polypropylene. You can see that most of them, they have carbon as their backbone. You can see like that. And what are the advantages of the polymers? Polymers are in fact engineering materials and fast replacing metals in many, which we'll, I've already told, I will discuss also later. What are the advantages of polymers? Why we study polymers? Basically, they are lightweight, they have good thermal and electrical insulation capacity, they are resistant to corrosion effects and are chemically inert, they have good workability and their fabrication costs, they have good strength, dimensional stability and toughness, they are transparent in appearance, have good dye, ability and process, decorative surface effects. Polymers absorb the mechanical shocks and show resistance to abrasion effects. But they have a lot of disadvantages also. And they are high cost materials. They are easily combustible. They have poor conductivity. They deformed under applied load. They have low thermal stability and brittle at low temperatures. But one of the most important disadvantages we come across in our daily life is, you know, it adds to environmental pollution, because most of the plastics which we throw out have this you know, problem, and this has to be taken care of by the governmental agencies. And what are the applications of polymers? You come across polymers in food containers, non-stick surfaces, aircraft windows, because non-stick surfaces in the frying pans, these polymers have been extensively, because and then aircraft windows, acrylics. Because in aircraft window, what happens is when you cover it with polymer like acrylics, what happens is the weight of the air, weight would be less. So the aircrafts can fly faster. Then you have bearings and gears. Then you have pipe housing insulation. Then you have applicants housing, toys, adhesives. And then we talk about other materials because this is also have immense applications because many times we use conducting polymer or polymer with ceramic composite. The ceramics basically comes from the Greek word keramos, which means pottery. You see in the villages, you see people, they are making pots. Pots are nothing but it is basically one of the ceramic material. The ceramic material plays very important role in the area of sensors, actuators, and smart systems. The design, development, and production of the devices based on fitness fundamental role in the field of various emerging devices. And ceramics have strong one advantage compared to polymers. Ceramics have advantage that they are very strong, they are brittle, they are low density, they have also insulating and poorly conducting. They are optically transparent, you can see them. And then one of the important thing is their melting points is very, very high. Typically, most of the ceramics have melting points of the range about 100 degrees centigrade. Whereas you take a typical polymers, many of the polymers about 50 degrees, 100 rupees, their melting point. They melt very fast compared to ceramics. So in many cases, when you want to make a material to have, most hard and all that, we make a composite with polymers and ceramic materials. So applications of ceramics are, they are used as pyramids, stone, china, porcelain, general construction work, windows, glass, and SiO2, cutting tools in abrasives, heat engines, refractories, electronic packaging, and electronic components. And about 50 years ago, we got a new types of polymers. Earlier days, we thought that all the polymers we come across, they are nothing but they are insulators. But about 50 years back, we found a new type of polymers. Basically, they are carbon-based, have come into existence, and they have conducting property. And the plastics have been used by electronic because of this very property. So at the start of 1960s, Plastic Research Laboratory, BASF, Germany, postulated new structural properties of polymers made by oxidative method. To their surprise, they found there's one conducting polymer, what is known as polythiophene. It shows conductivity about 0.1 Siemens per centimeter. And it was the first polymer which is capable of conducting electricity. Later on, people have been working on conducting polymers to show that whether it has how far its conductivity, what can be done. So what people have done using the various doping techniques, they try to increase its conductivity to some extent. Since then, about a dozen different conduct polymers and polymer undergo this transition when doped with a weak oxidizing or reducing agent. Most of them are unstable in air and were not capable of being processed. So these are the conducting polymers. So conducting polymers filled with conductive materials such as carbon black, metal flax, or fiber, so on, they are known as conducting. But the first thing, conducting polymer that has been, first invented and all that was done in the year 1970. They used acetylene is polymerized to form polyacetylene in black powder. And these three scientists, Alan Heger, Shirakova, and McDermott, these are the three people who initially worked in the conducting polymers. And they have proved that conducting polymers can, show some conductivity. And Alan Heger, Alan Dack found conductivity of trans polyacetylene increased with treated with halogen. And they showed that conductivity is of the order of about 38 Siemens per centimeter. And these three scientists have been awarded the Nobel Prize in the year 2000 in chemistry for their pioneering work in the field of conducting polymers. So these are the various types of conducting polymers we come across: conducting polymer composites, organometallic, polymeric conductors, polymeric charge transfer, inherently conducting polymers. And some of the conducting conducting polymers and their structure and all that I will discuss here. You can see one is polyacetylene. And this was discovered somewhere way back in about 1977. The structure looks like that. The energy gap is of this one is about 1.5 electron volt. Conductivity is the order of 10 to the power of 3 to 10 to the power of 5. Whereas you take polypyrrole, this was, you know, it was discovered in the year 1979. The structure looks like this, and energy gap is about 3.1, and their conductive order of 10 to the power of 2 to 10 to the power of 3. Polythiopin, 1981, this was done, and structure looks like that, energy gap is 2, and conductive order of 10 to 10 to the power of 3. And polyphenylene, 1979, energy gap is 3, and conductive order 10 to the power of 2 to 10 to the power of 3. And polyphenylene is of this order, energy gap is 2, here it is 3 to 10 to the power of 3. And polyaniline is energy gap is through, but conductivity here in this case 10 to the power of minus 3 to 10 to the power of 10. But I would like to tell you, and I will tell in the subsequent slides also, polyaniline and polypyrrole, these are the two materials that are extensively studied for various properties in among the conducting polymers. The reason behind is they are more stable and their processability is easier compared to other ones. Examples of conducting polymers. These are the conducting polymers and their structures. You can see from this slide also, you can see when you're talking about conduct polyacetylene, as I told you that conductivity order of 10 to the power of 3, 10 to the power of, but their stability is very poor, okay? And processing possibilities also limited. Well, is polyphenylene is also about conductivity maybe of the order of 10 to the power of 3, but stability is poor and processing possibilities is limited. PPS and even PPY, you can say they are all very poor. Even though processing, this thing is excellent, but one thing is their stability is very, very low. However, you take polyaniline, even though its conductivity is very less of the order of 10 to the power of 10 Siemens per centimeter, its stability is very good and processing possibilities is very good. Similarly, polythiopin, it is also, it's less, about 100 and 100, but as I told you, polypyrroles and polyaniline, which we have been able to study extensively. Because you can see both of them, their stability is very good and processing possibilities also are very good. And you can see the conductivities of various conducting polymers. You can see polyaniline, even though it is 10 Siemens per centimeter, polypyrrole is 10 to the power of 2, polyphenylene is liquid mercury, polyacetylene, and then you can see copper. Copper conductivity is the order of about 10 to the power of 6 Siemens per centimeter. Immediately following is polyacetylene. But only the problem, as we were telling you, the stability and all the other factors are not very good with them compared to these two. These are advances in strength to density of various materials. We can find carbon fibers and composites. They have a very good strength to density ratio. And why we study composites? So we have studied now materials, we have studied polymers, we have studied ceramics. Now the next part is we will make a composite. What is a composite? Composite is nothing but it is a natural autophilic mixture of two or more compounds. And primary engineering goal is to achieve a better balance of properties from the combination of metals. Mixtures may consist of metals, polymers, or ceramics. So I want to tell you this means when you talk about a material, suppose I take a like polyaniline example. Polyaniline melting point is very less. If I want to, if I want to use this material in a place where it requires a high, it has a very high temperature. Whereas you take a ceramic material is known to have a very high melting points. So the material does not melt that easily. Suppose if you make a composite with a polymer and a ceramic, you tend to have a better melting point. So that means better, basically it is nothing but it is a composite. So when you make a composite, you combine two materials so that your goal is to get a better property from the individual, what are the properties they have. So if you make like that, you will get a better property. So that is why what we do in engineering, when we make a composite, we can give some better properties. That's the reason we make composites. Composite general properties are they're very strong, they're ductile, they're low density and high tensile strength, and they are good, either they are conductors or insulators. Applications, they can use general construction, surf boards, transportation studies, high temperature materials. And it has a lot of application in other areas like transportation, aerospace, electronic packaging, biomedical, and sporting goods. And if you want to use in biomedical application, their main issues of compatibility are biocompatibility and durability. and crowns and implants, prosthetic device for artificial limbs, artificial bone, heart walls. Why I'm telling is, suppose biomedical application means when you take somebody has a fracture and you want to insert a, you know, material inside it, it should be biocompatible. It should be compatible to our body, and it should be durable. And most of the dental implants, what we are coming in, they are mostly used for the composite materials like ceramics and all implants. And similarly, artificial limbs, artificial bones, heart walls, they are mostly made of the materials from ceramics, polymers and all. So these, all these composite materials have immense applications in many of the areas. So composite applications have a lot of in sports, sports goods and rackets and all, it can be used. You can see these are the sports applications, golf club and all, we use these materials. And even in missiles and all that, composite components have been extensively used. So planes and all, we use it. So one in the, among the composites, one is metal matrix component, where you have in the metal, the metallic base, we reinforce with a ceramic base in order to achieve a better combination of attributes not attained by either constituents individually. Based on matrices, you have metal matrix composites, ceramic matrix, polymeric matrix composites. So when you talk metal matrix, you have application pistons, cylinders, brake discs, drive shafts, push rods, connecting rods, brake calipers, electrical insulation. And you can see all this has good applications in automobiles like pistons, piston ring, brake pads, motor, rotors. In automotive applications also we use. But why to use composites is it saves weight, it helps in cost reduction, energy savings, improved performance, reduction in noise level and environmental pollution. And we in our group, we work in area like what are known as conducting polymer, polyaniline. And this one area at polypyrrole also we study. I'll take up a work on polyaniline. So what we do, polyaniline, we do with their morphological study. Morphology means we want to study structure. Study the structure by using the standing characterization like techniques like scanning electron microscope, tunneling electron microscope, TEM and all that. And we also synthesize the conducting polymer with metal oxide nanocomposites, conducting polymer, ceramic nanocomposites, conducting polymer, fly ash composites. We also studied its electrical properties. And one of these applications which have worked very well, in particularly in sensing studies, humidity, LPG and explosive gases and battery applications. So this is the chemical structure of polyaniline. And how we carry about the synthesis of polyaniline? So aniline and hydrochloric are mixed in this ratio in 100 ml of, and to this 1:2 ratio of aqueous amine was added, and they stayed for about 2 hours. Then we get a green precipitate. This precipitate filtered and washed, and then grease is dried under vacuum at 60, and emerald salt is collected. So idea behind our work is we take a conducting polymer like polyaniline, we take a ceramic material, we make a composite. This ceramic material may be a nanomaterial also. These are the how we go about the synthesis for the composites. And this conducting polyaniline application in batteries, LED photo micrometers, optical storage, supercapacitors, harmonic generators, magnetic recording. So initially we studied DC conducting properties. You can see using this one, employing some of this formulae we are using. At high temperatures, we use this, at low temperatures and very low temperatures. So this is the, you know, we fabricated a furnace with all these attachments so that we can study our DC conductor. And we measure with the help of a Kittley 6514 electrometer. And this will help you in a lot of applications we can know from the DC conductor. So these are some of the results we got for various composites. Like, so we take polyaniline with some metal oxide or ceramics. We add in various weight percentages and we can see this is for a pure polyaniline. This is for the various weight percentages like 10, 20, 30, 40, 50. This is for polyaniline with NaBO3. And similarly, we have done for ZrO2 also for various composites. Similarly for molybdenum oxide also with various weight percentages. We We also done for so many other materials like SRTFO3, rare earths also, we have done this work. And we also studied the AC conductivity, and we have purchased this LCR Q meter, and which is a very good equipment. This was imported from UK. And AC conductivity can tell you a lot of information like various relaxation mechanisms and all. So this is some of the results we got. Variation of AC for various composites like the various rare earths like SRTFO3, CaTFO3 and all. So and where for various weight percentage we got. We can see the initial up to 10 to the power of some 4. See, more or less they are flat. And then there is a sudden steep hike it's taking place. But most important is we want to see, basically we work in the area of material science. In the area of material science, it is not only what you do academically, it should have some applications. So application part is a very important. So we have taken sensing work. So we have done both humidity and the gas sensing, because nowadays any projects or anything, any funding, you need some application. People want some application. So you can say that I have done this work, but people want, what is the use to the society? It has to be some use to the society. So we started to work on sensing studies. Initially we studied on humidity sensing and then gas sensing. So this is a small indigenous setup we have made for humidity sensing. So we have a chamber like this, and we insert a sample here, and we induce humidity in this chamber using a hygrometer, and then we study the change in resistance using a Keithley electrometer. And this is the work we have carried out: variation of resistivity with change in relative humidity for polyolein, cobaltous oxide for various weight percent like 10, 30, 50, any. And this work has been reported and published in Census and Actitas. So one of my students, Nasima Parvatikar, he is there in Bangalore only. Working, he has published, and this is one of the very good work we have carried out, which has a very high citations. And flammable gas sensing using conducting for tantalum oxide, this was also, the work has been carried out. So using PANI with the tantalum oxide, we make composites, and we study this for gas sensing. This was indigenous gas sensing which we have done in our lab. We have a cylinder, we insert a gas inside this chamber. We keep a sample here. We see the change in resistance using the Keithley electrometer. So this is the variation of resistance for parts per million for polyaniline tantalum oxide. We can see that how the behavior, sensitivity versus the parts per million. You can see the sensitivity of this one is very good for this composite. That means for 48%. We have also seen the variation of sensitivity as a function of Tulane for sensing response of PANI and PANI graphene composites, nanoparticles you can see. And you can see also their, the temp pictures, SEM pictures for the 15 weight percentage. As per the gas concentration for this, we have seen the sensitivity. And this is what we have carried out for bulk materials. Now I'll come back to the nano materials. And in India, this Professor C.N.R. Rao was the first person who pioneered and fostered nanoscience in India. And when he was in the DST, in various committees he was heading, he has started a DSC nanoscience initiative, wherein they have identified many universities and R&D institutions, and they have funded them so that they can do some good nanoscience work. And what is a nanoscience? Nanoscience is nothing but it is a combination of physics, chemistry, and biology called metals. But nanotechnology is physics, chemistry, biology, and engineering. Because when we do, as I was telling you, when you do work, you should have some application. So applications, the engineers have to come and play. And so that whatever nanoscience and technology, we need to have a good combination of all these people to come out with a good product, and which can be viable and can be used to the mankind. And these are the people we should not forget. Richard Feynman, he is a professor, he was a Nobel laureate, and he predicted the nanotechnology in a landmark talk in 1959 at Caltech, where he said that he speak against the possibility of maneuvering things atom by atom. And I had the fortunate to have listened to his talk when I was at California. And other person by name Eric Drexler, he's a great scientist who has also visualized that these nanomaterials will have immense applications in the years to come. What is nanotechnology? A nanotechnology of making things small, a science of understanding tiny smoothing called nanoelectronics. When did this nanotechnology start? In the year about 1990s, tools were in place to manipulate and observe materials nanoscale and studied exponentially. In the year 2000, a nanotechnology initiative were announced in the United States, and similar initiative were also launched in Europe and Pacific Rim. What is a nano? Nano in Greek means dwarf. That means very, very small. And nano is infinitely smaller than a dwarf. It is 1/1,000,000th of a meter or 10 to the power of minus 9 meter. You can see the various materials and the sizes. You can see atoms of the order of about 0.1 nanometer. DNA is about 10 nanometers and one panel. That's why when you talk about nanotechnology, you can see it has a lot of applications in biology. See virus, about 100 nanometers. Bacteria, 1 micrometer. Animals have 100 micrometers. Flies and all, they are very small. So nano basically is about 10 to the power of minus 9 meters. How small are the nanoscale particles? You can see each of this one, particles, how they look like. These are in the nanoscopic dimensions. These material like virus, you know, immunoglobulin, fluorine, all this, they are in the nano regime. They are not, these materials are not exactly in the nano range, but they are nearing nano range. But where are these materials like virus and all? They are in the nano range. What is the importance of nano? When you do nano sizing, what it will do? Nano sizing causes change in various properties. It will change the color. It will change the conductivity. It will change the melting point. It will change the light absorption. It will change the crystal shape, magnetism, chemical resistivity. You can see this one. See that as you are reducing the size, you can see the change in the color. So if you see the indium nanoparticles, you see the gold nanoparticles have different sizes. They have different colors. That means the color gets changed as you are changing the size. This is one example. But how do you classify the nanotechnology? Nanotechnology has been classified into three categories: wet nanotechnology, dry nanotechnology, and computational nanotechnology. Wet nanotechnology is study of biological systems that primary in water environment, nanometer structures, genetic material, membranes, enzymes, and other cellular. Dry nanotechnology derived from surface science and physical chemistry, focus on fabrication of carbon structures. Computational nanotechnology permits the modeling and simulation of complex nanometer structures. What about nanoscale? Why we study nanoscale is I will briefly tell. Most important is when you have materials in nanoscience, here it has a very good, first thing is, as I was telling you, it size dependent properties now. And most of these nanomaterials, they have very good surface to volume ratio is very, very high. You see an example, if you take 3 nanometer iron particle, has 50% atoms on the surface. If you take 10 nanometer particle, it's 20% atoms surface. 30 nanometer has only 5%. That means as the size is reducing, you can have better percentage of atoms on the surface. That means surface to volume ratio is very high as you are making the size smaller. If you see this example, gold, if you take gold as a bulk material, it shines as a metal. But when we when you decrease the size of that one, it is no longer, you know, shinings. It no longer shines. They do not shine like bulk gold. Bulk gold is chemically reactive, whereas that is why we make jewelry of gold. If you take bulk gold, it is chemically reactive, we make jewelry of gold. Small particles of gold, however, chemically, there's some small issues have come, I think. Okay, they are no longer metallic and they don't, this thing. Whereas if you take a melting point, you see the melting point changes with size. As the size is changing, melting point has also changed. Small particles of gold melt at a much lower temperature than a big piece of gold. So another size dependent property is the band gap. Band gap changes with the size. For semiconductor like zinc oxide, cadmium, you can see it changes with size. band gap is the energy needed to promote an electron from the valence band to conductor band. This another size change that takes place is magnetic properties, where magnetic for magnetic materials like iron, cobalt, nickel, ferrite and all that, magnetic properties are size dependent. The coercive force or magnetic memory needed to reverse internally within the force is size dependent. This is the reason that most of the magnetic materials are size dependent. And you can see that in a size is color is caused by partial. Why color is, you know, changes is because there will be an absorption light of takes place by electrons in matter, resulting visibility of the complementary on a smooth metal surface. Light is totally reflected. In a smooth surface, it is totally reflected. Whereas in a, you know, when it, where small particles, if you see, it absorbs leading to the some color. This is a size dependent property. If you take very, very small properties, there it will change. You can see this cadmium sulfide. As the size is, you see, size is decreasing, the color is also changing. But how do you make the nanomaterials? There are different techniques to synthesize nanomaterials: chemical vapor deposition method, microwave method, self-propagation combustion method, interface method, hydrothermal method, solvothermal method, and green synthesis. Since most organic polymers do not have intrinsic charge carriers, the required charge may be provided by oxidation or reduction. So we do some doping with all that, you know, charge defects can be or introduced. These are the, some of the dopants we come across: natural dopant, ionic dopant, organic dopants, polymeric, ceramic, and metal oxides. But normally in most of our work, we are using ceramic and the metal oxides. This is polyaniline, the structure. The various phases, lipodiamidal phase, emerald phase, emerald salt, and all that. And we use, in this case, we use a combination of conducting polymers with some metal oxides. So we use various metal oxides here to suit our studies. So if you take how to synthesize a nanopolyaniline, this is the technique. You take aniline and hydrochloric acid, you combine to flow aniline and hydrochlorine. They have US, SDBSC, ammonium persulfate, you add them, and then you get all this. Ultimately, you get a nano. So this is what we get in 12 hours. So in 24 hours, you know, what is the nanopolymer we get would be of this structure. You can see the structure. This is for 12 hours. This is for 24 hours. And if you want to take the composites, synthylene, polyene, cadmium oxide, you can also do like this. This is the flowchart technique. You take aniline, hydrochloric, you can, then you can add cadmium oxide. The same technique we complete, ultimately we get nani, pani, and cadmium oxide. You can see the CM and TEM picture here. Similarly, you can do the other synthesis of other nanocomposites like titanium nitrate, because we want to do TiO2. I think most of you know that this TiO2 is one of the material which has very good optical properties. So this is one area we would like to study, and it has a good sensing property as well. So we have taken synthesis polyaniline TiO2 nanocomposites. This is how the synthesis of this synthesis technique, how we follow. It is a more or less a similar what we have adopted for the other nanocomposites. You can see its TEM image. So orthopani with ZnO nanocomposites also, we have carried out some work. You can see their structure. And as you do know, we want to study its LPG sensing studies. What we have concentrated is, here in this case, we concentrate mostly on the LPG sensing properties. And we have used a two probe DC measurement technique where we used to measure the electrical resistance in the presence of LPG. And this is the sensor studies we got. And how the sensor mechanism works is basically is two reasons: trapping of LPG molecules in between the pure polyaniline or polyaniline composites by electrostatic forces. Second, due to the surface reaction of nano MO with LPG. And because of that, their sensitivity enhances for the polyaniline composites. And nano-sized particles provide one of the advantages why we study this one is, they have a very high surface to this. This is what I've been studying. We have also shown some pictures where 3 nanometer have more surface to volume ratio compared to 10 meters and 30 meters. Same thing, nano-sized particles produce high, thus results in a high quantity of surface area which can be lead to insufficient surface coordination and high surface energy. Therefore, surfaces are highly active, which promotes further absorption at room temperature, and there are more oxygen which. So when the sensors are exposed, what happens is LPGs will react with the adsorbs oxygen and release the trapped back to the conduction. This leads to increased carrier concentration of pollen and decreasing the resistance of the sensors. And some of the work we carried out for LPG sensitivity for panic cadmium oxide, you can see the gas concentration in parts per million versus change in resistance. Here this graph slightly not clear. We have sensitivity versus time in minutes. For each of these cases, we see what is the response time and what is the recovery time. And this should be good for many of the things. You can see this one, it, you know, recovery and this time for various, you know, various concentrations and all that. So this is for titanium oxide, you know, how the, this is the concentration in parts per million and how the sensitivity. You can see the sensitivity of this one is very good. So you can here also, we have seen time per minute for sensitivity for many of them, what with the response time and all that. You can see initially, for initial time in seconds, this this is very good, about 20 minutes, 13 minutes like that. And this is for orthochloropany and with ZNO, we can see here also how the sensitivity and the gas concentration and what would be the response time, recovery time for each of these composites. And if we want to see the relative humidity curves also, you can see for panic cadmium oxide, how the humidity looks like. And we have also some of the studies on microwave properties. Microwave properties, why we study microwave properties is microwave properties has very good applications for the defense, particularly in an area called what is known as the stealth technology. These conducting polymer composites, they can be used as a microwave absorbers. I'll show you some of these things. You can see, you can keep your poly, you know, this is a coaxial waveguide adapters. In that, you can keep your sample and study its properties. So the prepared samples were shaped to fit into the rectangular expand waveguide 8 to 12 gigahertz for microwave measurements. The complex scattering parameter, that means S1, 1, 2, and S2, and transmission S21, S2, the composite samples were studied using a vector network analyzer, that means Hewlett-Packard network as a 6719. So you have taken some composites like PANI with PBTFO3. With what frequency, what would be the absorption coefficient of these materials? You can see this material has fairly good absorption. You can also see, you know, for some of the other materials, what would be the reflection loss for this material? And we can see these dependence of reflection loss for PANI, PBTFO3 and distribution. You can see the distance between the each of the distance between the various oxide composites. Dependence of the frequency of the return loss of the PANI, PBTFO3. Like that, we have also done for polypyrrole. Instead of polyaniline, we have done for polypyrrole with molybdenum oxide. So this has been some of the work we have carried out. But in all these cases, in polypyrrole MO3, permittivity value is found to decrease with the increase in thickness. In these components, strong polarization occurs. With the increase in the dipoles present in system, can orient and all that. So among all the composites, this 50 weight polypyrrole MO3 shows real and imaginary permittivity values, and other composites have values. So we have also studied some mechanics. Of course, this is nothing to do with conducting polymers. These are some of the my students have carried out. I just want to brief you about that. We have done on polymethylene oxide in PMA. And this work has been done by two of my PhD scholars who are there from mechanical engineering background. Because mechanical engineering people, they require work in polymers, but they have studied the tensile properties and all that using the, you know, universal UTM universal testing machine. With that, with under about 1 kilonewton load cell at constant, that's they have done. They have tested about 5 specimens, and these are their results for them. Weight of the fly ash with tensile modulus and tensile strength against strain graph. And one more area where nanocomposites have been immensely used is, you can see microbes in my biofactories. A lot of these biofactories, you can use these microbes, you know, you can make a nanomaterials and it can be used. This potential for microbes, microorganisms constitute a large and unexpected reservoir likely to provide useful to man. And one of the applications where they can be used is this potential of microbes, antibiotics, enzymes, growth factors, immunomodulators, anti-cancer and anti-cholesterol agents. And before that, we'll talk about nanomedicine. Nanomedicine has immense applications. It is an interdisciplinary area with simple physics, engineers, medical and material chemists, biologists, and all that. Even the doctors can play a role. So nanomedicine can be used to build structures and devices and all that. So what are the various nanomedicines we can come across in our daily life? You can see potential nanomedicines can be used in drug delivery, particularly in cancer patients. You can focus it, target specific, you can do it. And then improving imagery, DNA analysis, implant materials. As I think already I discussed implant materials, artificial tissues, improving veins, cleaning teeth, lungs and arteries. These are the various human targets where nanomedicine can be used. So this is one of the applications where drug delivery nanomedicine can be. You have a tumor here, you can insert a nano cell, and this is a very target specific. If you insert a nano cell on this one, on the tumor, then the possibility of that curing will be faster than if you ingest orally. Nanoparticles can deliver drugs in sophisticated and like target specific delivery, enables the use of lower doses because the whole body is not saturated. If you send it, it is not necessary whole body will get saturated. Only you want to be at the particular target, you want to do it. So side effects will be minimized and it's possible to use stronger drugs. Use of gold particles, cancer healing, gold plated spears are also can be used. And it is can be used in implant material. Suppose there is a bone, there is some problem and all that, there is a fracture and all that, you have a coated implant can be kept as a here you can implant it. But as I told you that this should have a good biocompatibility and all that durability. And cleaning nano robots can be used to clean the tooth cleaning, to collect harmful bacteria from the mouth if it is there. You can using the nano robots. Like this can be extra fat also can be removed using the, of course, these are some of the areas is not exactly related to conducting polymers. I just want to share these things. Respirocyte, this is another important application of the nanomedicine. It is nothing but artificial mechanical blood cell, which can be inserted in the body. This was first, in a technical paper by Robert A. Freitas. This is, if you take a nanostructured device, it can use it. It can store in a better way. That means the storage capacity will be much higher. In artificial tissues and organs, nano devices. So this is one material which we have, Miminopodisa, which we have synthesized with the help of my collaborators in other departments. This can be, synthesized with zinc nitrate, magnetic stirrer and all that. Finally, you will get a ZNO nanostructures, green synthesis of ZNO nanostructures. And this has been used for various applications. You can see their XRD pictures. But what very important of this application is, they will be used in antibiotics and all that. It can give a better efficiency of the antibiotics when you coat it with zinc nanoparticles. This is the antifungal of the ZNO nanoparticles. So I would like to end my talk. This nanomaterials and all or nanocomposites, they have a very bright future and many of the properties will be put to use. There are some of the nanoscience, nanotech which are yet to be explored. There are many challenging aspects of the subject where research and development are necessary. This includes certain, there are also some negative aspects such as toxicological effects will be there. But let us take a best one which will be useful to society and we should do it. Before I end the talk, I want to thank all my PhD students and my collaborators who helped me to able to do some reasonable amount of good work. This would have been possible only with the help of my own scholars and my collaborators, and because of that, they could help me getting the BSR faculty fellowship, which is a very prestigious fellowship in this country. So I thank one and all and organizers for giving me an opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, sir. At this outset, there are a few question and answer session. We'll start, sir.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
Yeah, there are a few questions which was reflecting in the chat box. What is PPV?
PPV means parts per million. Parts per million. So that is how they put the concentration of the gases, I think, chemicals in that. They call PPM, parts per million.
Can conducting polymers be used as a storage cells?
Yeah, it can be. But not much work has been done, but there is work is going on. Because most of the storage, earlier days, we are using ferrites. Ferrites are materials where you store the materials. But now with conducting polymers with ferrites, the work is going on, but still not, you know, I can say it's completed, but work is on the progress. With conducting polymers with ferrites, you can improve the better storage capacities.
Okay, so the next question is, titanium with polymer, can it be a good conducting polymer composite?
Yeah, conducting polymer with titanium oxide is a good one. And we have also, I think I've shown some slides also, the sensitivity, you know, the sensing would be improved with that. And it also can improve the optical properties.
Yes, sir. Few of them said that we started to synthesize Pani, but failed miserably. We don't recognize where we failed. Can you throw some insights on that?
But Pani is supposed to be very easily synthesizable. I don't know where is the problem coming. I have no idea. What is their exact problem? Let them send to me. I will try to help them out.
Yes, sir. It's
Pani is one of the very, very easily synthesizable materials. When you take polypyrrole is there. So we the two conducting polymers, we have done a lot of work. But compared to that, polyaniline is a material which can be easily synthesized and there should not be many issues with it. I don't know. But if at all there is any problem coming up, we are ready to help them.
Yes, sir. How can we increase conductivity of biopolymer?
That still we have not worked out on that. I cannot tell exactly. But there are people have been working on biopolymers. I think they are not looking into the conducting part. So biopolymers can be used in sensing. It can be used like biosensor. There it can be have a better application instead of concentrating on the sensitivity part. I mean conductivity part.
Okay. Yes, sir. Why titanium oxide has good optical properties compared to other optical sensitive materials?
But titanium inherently it has a good optical, it is known for transparency and all that. Titanium oxide it is a good diamine. But there are other properties also, but titanium is known for it. It has its own property, I mean.
How to convert normal PU foam to conducting PU foam and its application?
The copper is basically a conducting only. We don't study, I think you mean if with polyaniline, you want to study the copper as a composite and want to study it? Copper by nature itself is a conducting material. Because why we want to do it is we study conducting polymers. We want to get the conductivity like copper because copper is known to have a weight is more than a polymer. So we want to get into a conducting polymers to reach to that copper or some of the metals so that because basically they're lightweight, they can be, fabricated to any form of their size. That's why we study conducting polymers for copper. We don't need to go to copper. It's not necessary for us to, have a copper into conducting polymers and do anything. I personally is not required, I think. But if you want to study the conducting property of that one, if you want to study with polyaniline, with that, we can do a composite. On its nature itself, copper is known to be a good conductor.
Yes, sir. The next question is, can we use piezoelectric nanomaterials as a pacemaker battery?
Yeah, it can be done.
Yes, sir. I think we have covered most of the questions, sir. What is the power output of conducting polymer in battery applications? That's the last question, sir.
No, I don't know correctly. I think there are a lot of people have been working. You can ask Dr. Veenu, madam. She is a better. She worked in that area. because I have not done some work on batteries in the initial stages. Right now, we are not doing much work on batteries applications.
Yes.
I don't have exactly an idea. I think I had to look back.
Definitely. Sir, we feel very proud to have you here. Thanks for giving your valuable time. And I shift on to Dr. Rupa Ma'am for oath of thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Is it hearable? I'm hearing.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, yeah. Please go ahead.
Myself, Dr. Rupa, Department of Physics, AMC. It is my great pleasure to propose the oath of thanks for all who have made it convenient to attend this webinar. First and foremost, I thank our management, Vice President Rahul Kaluri, sir, for giving the great support and to organize this webinar. My sincere thanks to Dr. MVN Ambika Prasad, sir, webinar speaker, for his valuable, very pleasant and informative session on conducting polymers, nanocomposites and its applications. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
I also thank our beloved principal, Dr. A.G. Natarajan, sir, for his valuable support and guidance. I thank Mustaq, sir, CSC department, for the technical support. I extend my thanks to all HODs, faculties, and participants for making this webinar a grand success. Thank you, one and all. Over to Ramakrishna.
Yes, ma'am. There is a small instructions to all the participants. As you already instructed, the feedback thing, the feedback link will be posted directly to your email ID after 24 hours. The link will be active for next 24 hours. Please do fill the link immediately. The e-certificate will be reflecting in your inboxes. Thanks for supporting us in this outset. I hope I'm clear. The feedback link will be sent directly to your email IDs. And I thank everyone. Thank you. I once again repeat, the feedback link will be sent directly to your email ID. And it will be active for next 24 hours. You can fill the feedback link immediately. The e-certificate will be reflecting in your email ID. Thank you all.
I'm going to go to the next one. Right.